Okay, let's look at this page. This is a problem we will be studying today on the blackboard. Now, you see this sphere over there. It looks nice. I think it looks nice. Do you agree? It has this spherical shape and all that. But it is kind of useless. It is one of the things that are useless, but they just look nice. Well, you also see these vector signs over there. You see this vector sign over there. I don't know if they look nice or not, but they are useful. They are an integral part of these expressions over there. So if you write this expression without these vector signs, they are wrong. You might think that they are right, but they are wrong. So if you didn't put the correct vector signs, you lost points. Okay, so the first thing that that caused you to lose points. If you don't put the vector signs, the question is gone. Well, the other extreme is that this I expect in the third quiz, because once I warn the students that they have to put the vector signs, they just start putting vector signs over everything. This also causes you to lose points. Mass is not a vector, it's a scalar. So you have to know what you are writing down. Whether you are writing a scalar, whether you are writing a vector, you have to be aware of that. And if you just put them in the wrong places or don't put them, it just means that you are not really understanding it. Well, this is also a common thing. You put a vector sign on one side, no vectors on the other side. This just tells me that you are equating a scalar. This is a scalar. There is nothing that signifies that it's a vector. As a number is equal to a vector. This is wrong. Well, if you ignore units, this is also quite common. If in the quiz there was the mass is 1 kilogram, so the F is equal to M times A, M is 1, so F is equal to A. This is wrong. F and A has, well, you forgot the vector signs to start with. Secondly, the two sides of this expression have wrong units. Units, just like the vector signs, is an important part of the expressions that you have. It gives us information. So if you don't give that information, then the thing that you write down is wrong. You lose points. If you write A is equal to 5 meters per second squared, that, well, of course you have to say that A is the magnitude or some component along one direction. This is the correct expression. This and this thing are completely different things. I don't know here if 5 is meters per second, kilograms per millisecond. I don't know. You have to put it there. Okay, once I warn the students about this, that they have to put the signs, the units, then I usually start seeing expressions like this. A is equal to V over R squared, meters per second squared. But this is also wrong, because the velocity here already has the units meters per second. R here already has the units meters squared. Well, this expression is wrong anyway. It's not V over R squared, it's V squared over R. But even putting these units over here is wrong, because the units should follow naturally from your equations. And that is a way that you can use to check your results. If the units do not match in both sides of the equations, that means you are doing something wrong. Now, another thing is writing this. A is equal to 6 over 2, so it is 3. Well, the unit is meter per second squared. This is also wrong. If you look at here, you are writing two equations here. A is equal to 6 over 2, which is wrong in terms of their units, and you are also claiming that 6 over 2 is equal to 3 meters per second squared. Both of these equations are wrong. So this, again, no points. So that is where most of you lost your points in the quizzes. Now, why are they important? Now, when you are solving a question that is like half a page long or just two lines, of course you remember the units. You can check that the unit of something was meter just two lines before, so you just can carry it out to three lines down. So you know that the unit is meter per second squared or something else. So what's the point in writing the units all the time? The problem is here our responsibility as a department is to prepare you for the real life. That is for the when you become a researcher, an active researcher, an active scientist. And this is a typical calculation you will make. No matter what you do, whether you become a theorist, experimentalist, you will always be doing some calculations either on the computer or by hand. Well, this is something that I started, I don't know, like several months, 5 or 6 months ago. At the time being, I'm on the 27th page. It is not yet completed. I will probably need to do 30 more pages of calculation. This is a typical length of a calculation, by the way. It's not one of the long ones. And at the end, I will have 60 pages of calculation done not within just 5 minutes or a few hours, but done in the span of a year. So if I, when I find time and look at my papers, two months from now, I have to know what I mean when I write some equation somewhere, whether the notation I'm using there, whether it is a vector or number, or what units that I have. I have to understand my own calculations 2 months from now. So how many of you try to understand your own calculations after 2 months? Anybody else? So you probably have realized how difficult it is that even if it is your own calculation, you are the one who had done it, after 2 months, it is hard to understand what you are doing. To make things easy, you have to put these vector signs. And you have to put the correct units in the correct places, and you are not supposed to draw arrows. So you say, okay, you just, in your quiz, you just write something. In some other place, you just make a round here. Okay, when you are writing this thing, it might be meaningful to you, but for somebody who is supposed to be reading that thing, it doesn't have any meaning. Why did you move this thing from there to here? You have to specify it. You have to write it down. Okay, there are already questions are coming about the midterms. Of course, it is important that you get the correct answer at the end, but it is also important how you get that correct answer. So the way you solve, the steps that you went over. So you have to write down your steps, and your steps have to be correct. If you only get the correct answer without showing any intermediate steps, it is quite probable that you will not get any points. Because I don't know how you got that. Did you just make it up? You shouldn't get credit for making up things. And even if you get the result wrong, but your intermediate steps are correct, it is just in one or two places you just mixed up some signs and some you forgot some factors, then you will probably get most of your points in the exams. Okay. Any questions? So let's continue. So what we were doing in the last lecture, do you remember? Yes, what we were doing in the last lecture. Not the first two rows. Yes, uniform circular motion. This is what we were studying in the last lecture. We have many examples of this in our everyday life. A car taking a curve is making approximately a circular motion for some time. It is also approximately uniform. Or the planets, they are making approximately uniform circular motions around the sun. And you can find many other examples of uniform circular motion. And we said that, okay, so if this is my mass, making a uniform circular motion. So this is its velocity at some point V1. This is its velocity at some point v2. Can you see it? No, okay. Nothing to do. So this is v1, this is v2. We know that since it is uniform, uniform means it has the same speed. Uniform means it has the same speed along the curve. Circular means it's just going around the circle. By the way, this doesn't mean that v1 is equal to v2. It's only their magnitudes are equal. V1 is equal to V2. If I don't put the vector sign without any other explanation, it just means the magnitude. The magnitudes are equal, but the vectors are different. So this is one of the reasons why you have to keep the vector signs there. If you write this one, this is of course true. If you write this one, this is of course false, because these two vectors, although they have the same magnitude, they are pointing in different directions. So if this is my v1, this is my v2. So the velocity vector has changed. And this is the change in the velocity. The acceleration is, of course, in the direction of the change of the velocity. The acceleration of my mass is the limit as delta t goes to zero of delta v over delta t. We had shown that the acceleration is always, these are things we had done in the last lecture. This is the acceleration at this point. This is the acceleration at this point. The acceleration is always towards the center, and it is always perpendicular to the velocities. And the magnitude of the acceleration is given by the speed squared divided by the radius of the circular motion. This is the radius of the circular motion. So these are everything we need to know about the kinematics of circular motion. We know that the velocity is constant, but we have to somehow either measure the velocity or it should be given to us. We should determine, either measure it or given by the question, the radius. Once we know the speed and the radius, the acceleration is given by this expression. So if there is an acceleration, Newton already tells us that there should be a force acting on my system. So now we are in the dynamics of this circular motion. There is acceleration, so there has to be some force acting on my object in the direction of this acceleration, in the same direction. So if you look at my object here, it has to be towards the center, the force. It is centripetal force. This is the force acting at this point. This is the force acting at this point. The magnitudes of these forces, the magnitude of the force, should be, it's just the mass times the magnitude of acceleration. So this is the force I have. It has to be pointing towards the center, and it has to have this acceleration. This is not a force acting on my mass, though. This is the force that other forces should create at the end. I should have other forces acting on my mass m, such that those forces, when I sum them up, they should give me a force towards the center with this magnitude. This is the force that should apply to the mass created by other sources so that my mass makes uniform circular motion. Is this clear? So let us just make an example. Yes.
In that solution, we're just talking about the magnitude.
Yes. Well, that is your homework, by the way. It will be in your next homework, where you will obtain these using vectors. Now, but one thing, you are right. We are talking about vectors here. We should mention two things: their magnitude and their direction. These are the magnitudes, and the directions are over here. They are in the central direction. Well, what we usually do to describe circular motion . This is my circular motion. This is my object over here. Now, up to this point, we always worked with x and y coordinates. I said that, okay, this is my x coordinate, this is my y coordinate. This is one way of describing the motion. Another way is to say that, okay, at this point, I can imagine a radial vector in this direction, in the direction pointing to my towards my object. And then I can, okay, let me also define this angle as theta. I can also have a perpendicular vector through this. So I can call this thing as r hat, then this unit vector perpendicular to this r hat vector, I will just give it a name, theta hat. Now the position of my object is in that direction, in the r hat direction. So it is r times in the r hat direction. This is the position. Of course, as my object moves, well, the position vector is quite simple in this representation. But the problem with this representation is, as my object moves, the x and the y coordinates do not change. But in this case, as my object moves, when my object comes here, the new r vector will be pointing in this direction, and the new theta vector will be pointing in that direction. So this r hat vector will be changing. R will be constant since I am told that the object is making a circular motion. From here I can calculate the velocity, r times dr hat by dt. Well, the details of this calculation are all in your homework. And once I calculate this one, I can just differentiate it to obtain the acceleration, and you can show that the acceleration will be given by v squared over r. The acceleration will be vector will be v squared over r in the minus r hat direction. This is how you can write it in vectorial form. Well, to take this derivative, what you need to do is you can just express this r hat vector in terms of this angle and the x hat and y hat vectors. So if this angle is theta, it is a vector with unit length. So the x component is cosine theta in the x hat plus sine theta in the y hat. By the way, this is the expression of a vector in terms of its components. The second question in the quiz. And then, of course, just taking the derivative, x hat and y hat vectors, they are just constant vectors. Theta changes as the object moves. So you end up having the velocity as a function of the rate of change of theta. Now you will have almost at least a week to work on that. Okay, so one example of uniform circular motion. Whose jacket is this, by the way? Nobody's? Okay. So if you hold it up, you let it rotate. So the bottom point makes uniform circular motion. This is one example. Of course, ideally you should make this with a massless string here and some mass attached to it, but even like this, it is making more or less uniform circular motion. You see that it goes around the on the surface of a cone, there is an angle over here, the theta angle. Let me just draw it. So this is the fixed point. This is the cone. This is the mass. So it just goes around this cone, on the surface of this cone. Now the length, let's just call it L. There is an angle over here, let's call it theta. The circle has some radius, let's call it R. So this is an example of a uniform circular motion, if the object is moving at constant velocity. Now let's draw the free body diagram for this. Okay, the free body diagram is the diagram in which you only show the mass. Here is my mass. You can show it up to here. We are still all the time assuming that the mass is point-like. So you can show your mass as a point. This is the point mass. And so what are the forces acting on this mass? There is a tension. The string will exert a force, and it will be in this direction. If this angle is theta, the angle that this force will make with the vertical is theta. And there's also its weight. This is the weight. And the magnitude of the weight is mg. This is the tension force. And note the vector signs. Here there is a vector sign, here there is a vector sign. And mg is not the weight vector. Mg is the magnitude of the weight vector. Well, let's just... Question? G is the magnitude of gravitational acceleration near the surface of Earth. So whenever we write g, we mean 9.8 meters per second squared. It's just a number. Well, let's just choose some coordinate axis. Vertical, we can choose the y coordinate. Horizontal, the x coordinate. So I can write down the components of my vectors. I have the tension force. Its magnitude is the tension on the string, which I do not know. Tension. Well, the y component, if you look at this right triangle over here, the y component is the length of the vector times cosine of this angle, cosine theta. It points in the y direction. And then the horizontal component of this t is, well, it is the opposite side of the right-handed triangle, so it is the sine. The x direction is pointing in this direction, so the force, the tension is pointing in the opposite direction, so the horizontal component points in the minus x direction. So this is the tension force. Now we have the weight vector. Its magnitude is mg, and it is pointing in the minus y direction. And these are the only forces acting on my mass. There is no centripetal force acting on my mass. These are the only forces. These two forces combined together should give me the centripetal force. If I add them up, the total force is, okay, in the y direction I have t cosine theta minus mg in the y direction and minus t sine theta in the x direction. At this instant, when my mass is at this point, these are the forces acting on my mass, and this is the total force acting on my mass. Well, at this instant, I also know that since it is making a circular motion, and I know that if an object is making a circular motion, it is accelerating, it has an acceleration pointing in this direction. And the magnitude of that acceleration is v squared over r. It is pointing in the minus x hat direction. It is accelerating. So this is the acceleration vector. We have the acceleration vector. That acceleration should be caused by this force. And Newton's law tells me that this force has to be equal to mass times the acceleration, which is minus m v squared over r in the x-hat direction. Now, this gives me two equations. The unknowns I have are, I don't know t, this is one unknown. And, well, I want to find the relation between its velocity and this angle theta. So it means, given theta, I don't know v. I want to find v. So the equations I have, well, this vector has to be equal to this vector. That is, the x component on both sides have to be equal. The x component here is minus t sine theta. The x component on the right-hand side is minus mv squared over r. This is one equation I have. Well, the other equation, the y component on the left-hand side, which is t cosine theta minus mg, this has to be equal to the y component on the right-hand side. Well, there is no y component, so it has to be zero. Well, to solve for the velocity in terms of the other parameters, I can just eliminate t. Okay, from this expression, I know that t is equal to mg over cosine theta. So this is what I have. I can substitute this thing into the first expression. Let's just cancel the signs over there. So I have mg sine theta over cosine theta should be equal to mv squared over, well, this is capital R. The radius of the circle is capital R. Well, capital R is L times sine theta. So this gives me an expression between the velocity and the angle theta. If I just cancel the masses, the velocity will be just the square root of g times L times tangent sine squared theta over cosine theta. This is the velocity of my object as a function of theta. So if you can measure the angle theta of an object making such a motion, then you can determine its velocity through this expression. By the way, this is an easy experiment that you can do at home. I mean, just pick up a mass. It can be a shopping bag, attach a string to it, and let it turn around. Well, the measuring the angle theta can be a bit complicated, but it will not be that complicated. Take a photograph, and from the photograph you can just measure this angle theta, and then you can find the velocity v. But of course, in order to test whether that is correct or not, you also have to measure the velocity v. But measuring the velocity v is not that difficult. The period of motion, let's call, well, this symbol is called tau. How are you going to find the radius? I don't need radius. Because radius is just L times sine of this angle. So if you know, you can measure L. From the photograph, you can measure theta. So you know, you can find R easily. But of course, to compare, to check whether this expression is correct or not, you have to calculate both sides independently, whether this is correct or not. I mean, this just tells you that the velocity should be this, but is the velocity really given by this expression? If you want to check that, you have to measure the velocity also, separately. Well, to measure the velocity, what you can do is, let us define the t as the period of rotation. That is the time it takes for my mass to complete one full rotation around the circle. This is defined as the time of one full rotation. Well, we know the speed. The speed is constant. Well, we don't know the speed, but the speed is constant, v. So in this time, tau, the total distance that my object, not the displacement, but the distance that my object covers is nothing but, since this is the time it takes for one full rotation, in one full rotation, my object covers a distance of 2 pi r. The radius, the circumference of the circle. Well, r is 2 pi l sine theta. Tau, to measure tau, you only need a watch. So measure tau. Once you have tau, you know that the velocity is 2 pi l sine theta over tau. This is an experiment that you can just do at home. The only thing you need is a shopping bag, some string of some length, and a watch to measure the period of the rotation. Questions? Okay, one critical thing, I would like to repeat it again. There is the centripetal force, there is no such force in the sense that other forces acting on my mass should create this centripetal force towards the center. It is not going outside. It's not a, there is no centrifugal force. Or in Turkish, merkez kaç kuvveti. It doesn't exist. There is only centripetal force, or in Turkish, merkezcil kuvvet, towards the center. Questions? Well, let's go back to our car example. So you are in a, there is this road. You are in a car, moving in this direction, and you would like to turn around the curve, take the curve. And let's suppose that the radius of this curve is r. Now, we know that it is making kind of a circular motion. So at this instant, the velocity vector is pointing in this direction. At a subsequent instant, the velocity vector will be pointing in this direction. So it is an accelerated motion. What is the source of this acceleration? Friction. So in which direction? So let me just draw it horizontally. This is my car. The velocity vector is towards inside the blackboard. So you are just riding towards the blackboard. And you are making a turn, a right turn. So what is the direction of friction? To the right or to the left? To the right. Who says to the left? Who says that the friction force will be towards this direction? Okay, one, two. Who says the friction force will be in this direction? Okay, so this time the majority is correct. You see, the velocity was initially in this direction. Then it will be in this direction. This is the direction of the velocity. So the velocity is changing in this direction. If the velocity is changing in this direction, there has to be a force pointing in this direction. The only force acting on the system in this direction can be the friction force. There is no other force. So there are other forces. There is the weight, the magnitude of which is given by mg. There is the normal force pointing in the opposite direction. But I know that the acceleration is in this direction. This is the direction of acceleration. None of these forces will create an acceleration in this direction. This acceleration will be created by the friction force. If you are driving, you should know that on icy roads, it is hard to take the curve because there is not enough friction to take a curve with a high speed. So you have to slow down, you have to go very slowly so that you will need a very small acceleration to go around the curve on an icy day. So if it is a friction force, is it static friction, kinetic friction, rolling friction? We had seen that the friction force, we had three types of friction. There is the rolling friction, which we ignore most of the time. It is negligible. There is the static friction, and there is the kinetic friction. Is it static or kinetic? So who says it is kinetic? Who says it is static? Well, this time the majority is wrong. It is static friction. Remember the definition of friction. When we were describing the friction, the important thing is the relative motion of the surfaces that is creating the friction, not the relative motion of the object as a whole. This is just like the walking example that we had. If you are walking, if you are accelerating in a given direction by walking, in that case, the friction between the sole of your feet and the earth is static friction because those two surfaces are not sliding on top of the other. Just like here. As the wheel rolls, the wheel is not sliding on top of the road. So if you just look at the wheel from the side. At this instant, although the wheel as a whole is moving, let's say, in this direction, this point of contact is not sliding. At the successive instant, it will be this point that is in contact with the road. So it's not that this point is sliding to this towards this point. It is another point comes into contact. So those the point of contact doesn't slide on top of each other. So if the two surfaces are not sliding on top of each other, in that case, we only have the static friction. So this friction force has to be in this direction. And it has to be a static friction force. So the magnitude of that friction force, we know that it is less than or equal to the static friction coefficient times the normal force. So is this point clear? That the direction of the friction force has to be towards the center because that friction force is what creates the centripetal force. That is our centripetal force. And that friction is static friction, not the kinetic friction. Although the object is moving as a whole, the surfaces of contact, they are not sliding on top of each other. The surface of contact is at rest. So that is why we have the static friction over there. Now let's calculate. Again, let's just choose our coordinate axis, the x, the y. The normal force is in the x direction. The weight is in the normal force is in the y direction. The weight is in the minus y direction. And the friction force, whatever its magnitude, is in the x direction. The acceleration of my object, of my car, is v squared over capital R, is in the x direction. Oh, okay, the first one was right. So the normal force is in the x direction. The weight is in the minus x direction. The friction force is in the y direction. And the acceleration is in the y direction. By the way, these intermediate steps is not useless steps. They are not steps that you can ignore in your homeworks or in your exams. These are the steps that I want you to go over, to write down in the exam in your solutions. Well, I have identified the forces, the three forces acting on my mass, so I can write down the total force acting on my mass. There is the static friction coefficient in the y direction. This is the only force in the y direction. The normal force, the weight in the x direction. This is the total force, and this has to equal to mass times the acceleration vector, which is m v squared over r in the y direction. Again, this just gives me two equations, one for the x components, one for the y components. The x components, it tells me that the x component on the left-hand side is n minus mg. On the other side, it is 0. This is 0. So the normal force is mass times the gravitational acceleration constant. The y component, well, here I have the friction force, Fs. This should be equal to m v squared over r. Now the question is, will the car be able to make this right turn without skidding? Well, this is the force that I need for the car to be able to make this right turn. And it is this, if we don't want the car to slide, skid, this should be the static friction force. So mv squared over r, which should be equal to the static friction force. But we know that this is less than or equal to the coefficient of static friction times the normal force. Or mv squared over r should be less than or equal to mu s. Well, the normal force is mg, mu s times mg. This should be satisfied. Or the velocity of my object, the masses, it cancels. Square root of this. So, of course, this is the condition that the velocity should satisfy if the car is not skidding. If the car starts to slide to the left, well, this is a wrong expression, by the way. The car doesn't slide to the left. The car in this example. If the velocity is larger than this one, then we know that there will not be enough friction force to accelerate the car in a sufficient amount so that the car can make this turn. The change in the velocity will not be able to follow the curve itself. So instead of going like this, if the velocity is larger, the car will just go like this and it will move out, go out of the road. If the velocity is larger than this, yes. Now, if the velocity is larger than, if the speed is larger than this amount, then what will happen is the car will start to skid. Since the surface of the wheel and the road will start to slide relative to each other, in that case, the friction coefficient will become not the static one, but the kinetic one. So what will happen is if the velocity, until you reach this velocity, you will be able to follow the curve. So until that velocity, until that speed, you will be able to follow this one. But the moment that you go above this curve, the moment that you start sliding, you will not be able to, well, what you would expect, in general, what you would expect, the velocity, if it gets a bit larger than that one, rather than following this curve, you would expect that it will follow a curve very close by curve. But even that doesn't happen. It just goes out of the road. Because the moment it starts skidding, the friction is now kinetic friction, and in general, the kinetic friction force is much less than the static friction force. So the force towards the center, it just drops, which causes you to move out of the road. Any questions?